This is a continuation of our previous video, where we revealed that we found the asymptotically optimal algorithm for factoring. You can check it out if you haven't yet, but hopefully this will make sense even without it. As many of you have guessed by the date that we published our previous video, it wasn't completely honest. The fact that the video suggested that we solved one of the biggest open problems in computer science may also have been a clue. But you know what? Although the video was heavily misleading, what we said there was actually true. Remember, we said that we have a concrete, asymptotically optimal algorithm for factoring composite numbers. Before explaining our algorithm, we need to understand the following pressing question. Why aren't we famous? After all, it's safe to say that even determining whether there is a polynomial time algorithm for factoring would be worth pretty much any prize a mathematician or a computer scientist could dream of. And so, the only possibility, however weird it may sound, is that although we know the asymptotically optimal algorithm, we don't know what its time complexity is. Okay, but even if we can't compute the time complexity of our algorithm, why not just run it on real instances like the one mentioned in the previous video? If we can solve the factoring problem really fast, we can break the famous RSA crypto system, so who cares that we don't have a proof that the algorithm is fast? Since we're not famous yet, the only possible conclusion is our algorithm must be very slow in practice. Remember, in computer science, we're using asymptotic complexity because it's often hard to distinguish whether the complexity of our algorithm is, let's say, this, this, or this function. So to make our life simple, we ignore the leading constant and the lower order terms and just call all of these functions O of n squared. And that's reasonable most of the time. But what if the complexity was 1 million times n squared? That's also O of n squared, but the algorithm would be extremely slow in practice. So asymptotic complexity can sometimes be deceptive. That normally doesn't happen, but you'll soon see that our case is, well, very exceptional. Constant factors in our algorithm are so ridiculously massive that it struggles to factor even the number 4. So with these two points in mind, let's now have a look at what our algorithm actually does. You may have heard of the infinite monkey theorem. It says that if you give a monkey a typewriter, after enough time of mashing keys randomly, it'll eventually manage to write the complete works of Shakespeare. But you know what? With enough time, the monkey will also write all kinds of valid Python programs. And in the remaining cases, Perl programs. And now, even though I don't know if there is an efficient algorithm for factoring, if there is one, the monkey will eventually manage to type it out in Python, given enough time. And this is exactly the idea behind our algorithm. Instead of hiring monkeys, we're just going to iterate over all strings in their lexicographical order and try to interpret each one as a Python program. We'll give the program the number we want to factor, let's say 4, on standard input. We'll run the program and check if, by chance, it printed the factorization of our number to standard output. Of course, most of the time, we'll simply get a syntax error. But on the few occasions when the program does finish, we'll check if it printed two numbers whose product is 4. Needless to say, this also usually doesn't happen, in which case we just continue with the search. But there is an issue with this approach. At some point, we'll encounter a program with an infinite loop like this one. And when that happens, our search will just get stuck forever, so we'll have to be a little bit smarter. We'll maintain a list of simulated programs. At the beginning, this list will be empty, and we're going to proceed in iterations. In iteration k, we first add the kth lexicographically smallest program to this list and then simulate one step of each program in the list. In this animation, each gear represents simulating one step of a program, where you can think of one step as one CPU instruction. For example, adding two numbers, assigning a variable, and so on. After we're done with all the programs in our list, we go to the next iteration, add the next program, and simulate one step of each program in the list, and so on. Of course, sometimes it'll happen that the simulation of a program finishes, either because the program returned an answer, or, more likely, it just crashed. Then we check whether the output of the program is two numbers whose product is equal to our input number. If not, we just continue with the simulation. But in the unlikely case that the finished program actually returned the correct solution, we print it to the output and terminate the whole search procedure. Fortunately, this final check can be done very quickly. And notice, by the way, that this is the only place where it actually matters that our problem is factoring and not something else. And that's the whole algorithm. It was discovered by Leonid Levin and is known as universal search, so let's use that name from now on. Perhaps you can already see how it's possible that we have no idea what the asymptotic time complexity of this algorithm is and why it's so slow that it struggles to factor the number 4. But the only thing we promised was that universal search is asymptotically optimal. In other words, we promised that whenever there is some factoring algorithm with time complexity f of n, then universal search has time complexity O of f of n. For simplicity, I just explained a version of universal search that has a bit of a weaker property. Whenever your factoring algorithm has time complexity f of n, I can prove our universal search has time complexity O of f of n squared. I'll now explain this complexity, and then I'm going to tell you how to improve it to O of f of n. So let's say you give me some program that needs f of n time to factor numbers with n digits. To have a concrete example in mind, we can think of the simple program that tries to divide the number by 2, 3, 4, and so on until it succeeds. The most important observation is that universal search will at some point start simulating your program. For this program, it'll be the iteration number, well, roughly 10 to the 160. Let's call this number L. L is ridiculously huge, but what's absolutely essential is that it's a constant. It doesn't depend on the length of the input number that we want to factor, it only depends on the source code of your program. Okay, so what happens next? In each subsequent iteration, we simulate one step of your program, so if it takes f of n steps to finish, we'll need to do that many additional iterations of universal search to simulate your program to completion. Since your program factors the number correctly, at this point, universal search will definitely terminate. Of course, it might also terminate even earlier because of some other factoring program that has already finished. So, what's the total number of steps that we need to make? Well, look at this triangle diagram. It shows how many steps were simulated in total. Of course, some of the simulated programs may have finished much earlier, but in the worst case, the time complexity of universal search is proportional to the number of dots in this picture. Since it took f of n iterations to simulate our program, we started the simulation of another f of n programs in the meantime. So the area of this triangle is roughly 1/2 of L plus f of n squared. And remember, L is just a constant, so this is simply O of f of n squared steps. Actually, there is one thing that we swept under the rug. Checking whether the outputs of the finished programs are correct also takes some time. Fortunately, if we use the fastest known algorithms for multiplication instead of the standard algorithm, the time we spend checking is negligible. And this finishes the analysis of the basic version of universal search. But how do we improve O of f of n squared to O of f of n, as I promised? Well, you can do that by tweaking the algorithm a little bit. Instead of simulating exactly one step of every program in each iteration, we allocate exponentially more steps for older programs. The complexity of this improved universal search becomes roughly 2 to the L times f of n, which is even more ridiculous than before, but big O can hide big constant, so it's O of f of n. This is also how we implemented universal search in our code. Speaking of implementation, there is a tiny difference between our code and our explanation. Since we wanted to make our code readable, we didn't want to go through simulating all Python programs. So we asked ChatGPT, and it told us about this amazing, high-powered language called Brainfuck, which is also so simple that we could write its interpreter. The rest of the code has two classes, Universal search implements the whole functionality of our algorithm that doesn't depend on which problem we're actually trying to solve, and the class universal factorization inherits from universal search and implements the only problem-dependent part, checking if the output of a simulated program is correct. I hope this makes it clear exactly how general the idea of universal search is. For example, let's say we want to solve another classical problem, sorting. Then we just need to write a new checking function for sorting, and voila, we now have an asymptotically optimal algorithm for sorting. In general, the only property of the problem that we're using is that there exists a linear time algorithm that can check if a proposed solution is correct. So this was Levin's universal search, and I expect many of you might now be a little bit confused about how to understand it. So let me finish with a bunch of thoughts about what the lessons to take away from it are. First of all, what I don't want you to take away from this is that asymptotic complexity is a broken concept. Let's say that we want to analyze some algorithm. There is a bunch of approaches that we could take. First, you could code the algorithm and empirically measure how fast it is as a function of input size. Or you can just compute the asymptotic complexity. Or if you're a hardcore theoretician, you can just check whether it runs in polynomial time on a Turing machine. You can see how these options get increasingly more abstract and easier to work with. On one extreme, analyzing an algorithm empirically is usually quite tricky because there's a lot of details that you need to get right. Computing asymptotic complexity is usually reasonably easy, and determining whether an algorithm runs in polynomial time is often obvious just by looking at it. But as these concepts get more abstract, they also get less informative. Just knowing whether an algorithm runs in polynomial time doesn't really tell us that much about it. Asymptotic complexity tells you quite a lot about an algorithm, but in many cases, like when you need to choose one out of several sorting algorithms with the same complexity, you'll really need to sit down and do some empirical testing. And so you can see that asymptotic complexity often lies in the sweet spot. It's usually quite easy to compute while still being informative. This makes it the right level of abstraction for many problems. And sure, it doesn't capture that some algorithms like universal search have really large constants that it hides, but most of the time it's just fine. Asymptotic complexity is just a model that computer scientists use, similar to physicists using frictionless surfaces, that don't actually exist. All models are wrong, but some of them are useful. But let's go back to universal search. Apart from being really weird, is it actually useful for anything? Well, already the fact that it is weird means that it's good to know it. It can help you quickly disprove conjectures and build intuition. It's a bit similar to all of those weird functions you might know from calculus class, like this one, or that one, or this one. All of these are really weird, and it's good to have them in the back of your mind, and the same goes for universal search. But there is also one direct application of universal search, albeit a very theoretical one. If you think about a concrete problem, like factoring, a priori it's not even clear whether there exists an asymptotically optimal algorithm. Why can't we just have a sequence of faster and faster algorithms without there being an asymptotically fastest one? Although it's possible to construct some absolutely unhinged problems where this does happen, in practice that's not the case. And the reason is, the optimal algorithm is universal search. So that's why in practice you don't get a sequence of faster and faster algorithms. In any case, I hope you enjoyed our videos about universal search, an asymptotically optimal algorithm for many problems. The content of this video was extremely subtle, so let us know if you're confused about anything and if you enjoy these less or more than our usual algorithm explainers. And before I go, there's two things that I wanted to mention. The first one is, we've set up a Patreon for the channel, so if you'd like to support us, please check out the link in the description. As a patron, you'll get beta access to the videos, so we'll release an early version to our patrons, and then you can send us feedback, and your suggestions will make it to the final product. And another thing is, I wanted to quickly plug a project that we've been working on with a few other friends, namely Impromptu. Impromptu is an AI-based party game where you use AI to generate weird images like cats sword fighting, and then the other players see the image and they try to come up with fake prompts that might have generated the image, and then you try to guess which prompt was the real one. So if that sounds like fun to you, check out the game, it's linked in the video description, grab a few friends and give it a go. And with that, I'll see you in the next one, bye bye!